Welcome back to part two. It is a bit of a Rotherham United special this week. We've got Ronnie Moore and John Breckin, two absolute Millers legends, our special guests. But we are going to discuss Sheffield football as well, particularly in this part of the show. We had the untold story of Ronnie Moore's one-time talks with Sheffield Wednesday and Leeds United in part one, all in this book by John Breckin, Breck, My Life in Football, which is a wonderful read. James Gregg joins us because there is news of an historic return to Sheffield for the world's oldest club, among other stories that we're going to pick up with James during the course of the show. But let's kick off with the events of, what was the date? 28th of April, 2001. John, Ronnie, anything much happened that day?
Just unbelievable day. What an absolute fantastic day it was. I mean, you know, I think we needed to win the game, Breck, if I recall. I'm sure we needed to win it. It depended on Redden's result as well. But what a goal by Alan Lee. And the rest is history when he actually, you know, the crowd coming on and lifting people up, dragging players off, lifting myself up. I mean, I couldn't get away. You know, I was mobbed and all that. So it was a bit like when I was a player and we actually won the league. Same thing. Absolute same feeling.
Well, this is to get promotion from the third tier to the second tier. And it was like back-to-back promotions that you achieved. It was a 2-1 victory over Brentford. Alan Lee's late, late goal. An old mate of mine, Brian Chappell, is doing the commentary. Let's relive it now.
Alan Lee, 30 yards out, it's on his left foot. He finds Watson. Watson's looking for an overlap. Then he turns away, plays it to the edge of the area, finds Alan Lee. Can he turn? He shoots!
Promotion to Rotherham United. 90 seconds left on the watch. Everybody's gone mad. I've gone mad. The fans are on the pitch. Who blames them? Alan Lee. Alan Lee, his 15th goal of the season. What a turn. And with Reading currently trailing at Lair Road by 2-1 and the Millers in front, Rotherham United, goodness gracious, I'm beginning to believe it. They're going to be in the first of it.
Well, my word, what am I? I just wish I was somewhere else that day. I really wish I'd been there because I covered a lot of Rotherham games at Millmore. John, I see you on the touchline at the back end of that clip, looking relatively calm. I think it's the realisation that you've just got to see it out from that point.
Yeah, the fans were shouting another result behind us, and I was trying to work that out. But when the goal went in, the first thing I was focusing on was obviously celebrate the goal, but the next thing was, let's see this game out. Let's just make sure we see this out, because how many times do you see it when it happens like that? The opposition then kick off, because there wasn't long left, but you know, you just want to hear the final whistle. So I was focusing probably on that, but then it hits you, doesn't it? It just really hits you, and the fans just come on the pitch and it's just bedlam then from then on. And to be honest, it's just a great place to be. Any football club, you know, you're blessed to get one promotion in a career, to get two back-to-back like that. And as I say, Ronnie and myself, we were blessed that we did it in 1881 with Porterfield, which it was unbelievable, because Ronnie were carried off the pitch exactly the same. The only thing was, this time, he'd come back with some clothes on. When he did it in 1881, all he had was his jog strap on. It was unbelievable, Alan.
He took the lot, didn't he? The pads, the boots.
He took everything.
The shirts.
Took his boots, took his shirt, took everything. So, no, it was just a fantastic day, the Brentford one. So, you know, when Alan turned and hit that, it took ages. It sent ages slow motion to go in. It just took ages at the bottom end, didn't it, Ron?
It did, yeah. You know, it was incredible, really, when you think about it. And like you say, you know, that day when we actually won the league, because we didn't win the league, that was it. If there was any disappointment out of the two,
yeah,
we got back-to-back promotions and both were runners-up. We'd have just loved to have actually just nipped it and actually won it. you know, a bit like we did when we were playing in 1881. But that day in 1881, there was no way I was running off the pitch because I turned around and all the players were running off. I thought, I ain't going anywhere. I'm milking this. And that's what happened. They just lifted us up above their head and everyone's nicking me boots and me pads. But it's a day you never forget, something like that. It was just an incredible feeling.
Do you remember the evening you had following that? Any memories of that?
Yeah, I can remember it well.
Didn't we have a party or something in the gym?
Yeah, the commercial side and with the council had got together and they'd put plants in the gym and made a bar in there and it were tickets only. People bought them and it were a massive disco, if you can say, in them days. But we'd gone in the boardroom, Ron, because a few guests had come down there and we were in the boardroom. We drunk it dry. And we just kept popping back in the gym and back out, but it was a long night. But you know, it's just an unbelievable.
Well, the great days, you can't buy them days, can you?
You can't buy them.
And they earned it. Every one of the lads, you know, when you look back, you know, them back to back promotions, and like I often say, I mean, for a team like us. To stay at that. We were so lucky, weren't we, that first year in the Championship. You know, we hung on and hung on. Because I didn't know, and I said, in the book, Les Payne says, we never won a game in the first 10 and never won a game in the last 10. So, and yet we still stayed up on goal difference that year, didn't we?
Yeah, well, I think, and the ones that we did do well in, it's because you didn't shave.
Yeah.
We went to Grimsby. Yeah.
I was looking like Father Christmas by the time we went to Grimsby, yeah. Wasn't I?
It didn't suit you either, but you said, I'm not going to shave until we win. And then you've gone in front of the crowd. It was packed at Grimsby, the Rotherham fans, after, and you've gone like that with the razors.
Just pretending to have a shave. Yeah.
It went crazy. Robbo scored two great goals that night.
He scored a goal or two, Robbo, couldn't he? Yeah, always had a little chip on his shoulder, didn't he? Like the moment, didn't he? Why are you taking me off again? He was there, you know, but he was tremendous at putting the ball in the back of the net.
Yeah. Especially when Guy got sent off, Robbo started to walk off. Guy got sent off.
Yeah, that's
Robbo
me off
was the
now.
First one. I'm going off here.
He was good, Guy, wasn't he? Getting sent off and denying everything, wasn't he? He was absolutely quality at that. When he punched a lad in the tunnel and said he'd never done a thing to me at half time.
Never did a thing.
Small blind. No, I didn't touch him, Gaffer. He'd only nearly knocked him out. He went on to be a boxer, that lad, didn't it, Leon? Yeah. What was his name?
It was the family, weren't it? It's gone, Ron. It's gone.
Yeah. I can't remember it, but yeah, he went on to be a boxer. So he picked the right one. He wasn't a coward, was he, Grano? That's when I was leaving out the side, that's why I always had you in the room. He was the only player that Brett, you stay in here. I'm having a chat with Guy and I'm leaving him out. So just cover me back here. Anything could happen. was a lad, he was, wasn't he?
Yeah, great lad. They were full of them, mate. Full of them. It was. There were great characters in that dressing room at that time.
James, what about the chemistry between those two?
It's great. It's great. I could listen to you two all day talking about it. Obviously, really fond memories for you both. So, I mean, it's just brilliant. I saw Alan at one point, got up and just stood and watched. Fantastic.
It's every time we get together. That's our relationship, to be fair. We might not see each other for a while because families, we've gone as families and we've gone different ways a little bit. But as soon as we get together, the stories start coming out and the things that we used to get up to at Millmore. Because not only that, most of it is in the book. We had to, when we got into the Championship, Ron, if you remember, we decided how to play that day. We were at the pitch, just me and you, at 6-7 o'clock at night, deciding whether we were going to go with a back four or a back three. And we brought the lines in.
Because we shortened the pitch, didn't we? We brought the pitch in and decided we were going to play three at the back, weren't we?
Yeah. And then on to going around Millmore how we could. I mean, we went in the away dressing room. We had to make it a fortress. We had to make Millmore really where teams didn't want to come. The big the big time challenges, as we'd say, the big clubs. You know, they come well, down to Millmore.
On the Friday, you want it. I mean, when we first took over there, we took the pegs off, if you remember. So there was only 11 pegs and they were all coming but suited up from London and all that. And they'd walk in, we'd mop the floor because it was a marble floor. It was ringing wet when they came in. So before we'd even started a game, we'd won just the mental part of the game where they didn't want to be there. It was a lot, and in the end, West Ham decided in their wisdom that they weren't going to change at Millmore. They actually changed in the hotel room, didn't they? Came to the game, and we ended up beating them 1-0 at our place.
Yeah, and we used to leave the order the dressing room door that were open at 11 o'clock in the morning for a 3 o'clock kickoff.
Yeah, but the draft coming through there at Millmore, it was freezing, wasn't it?
Yeah,
fantastic. Well, brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. I'm just going to deviate you ever so slightly onto the here and now, Sheffield football, but also Rotherham. Come to Paul Moore and the Millers in a moment. Moore on Moore. Ronnie Moore on Darren Moore's appointment. And you talked in the parallel in part one of how you were with a club, similar size to Doncaster Rovers. You had people nibbling away, looking to get you to a higher level. Darren Moore's taken the plunge and gone to Sheffield Wednesday. Is that right for Sheffield Wednesday and also right for Darren Moore? What do you say? What do you think?
Well, judging back on, like I said before, when I had the opportunity and didn't go, and then you get the sort of stabbing in the back and that horrible feeling you get when you are asked to leave. I think he's probably looked at it and thought, look, I think we've probably gone as far as we can go because Donny then going up or whatever will be a lot more difficult for them than it is at this moment. Sheffield Wednesday are struggling. Big club might go down. That's the pros and cons he's probably gone through. But it is a bigger club, no matter how you look at it. And he's probably thought, look, I might not ever get another chance like this. I think I'm going to go for it, dive in and see what happens. He's got nothing to lose. And financially, he's obviously going to be an awful lot better off as well.
Yeah, and a good appointment by Sheffield Wednesday. I mean, his record is impressive. He was very harshly sacked at West Brom. Very high win percentage there. Had them in a sort of contention for promotion. Again at Doncaster, playing good football as well.
Yeah, great football, and he's a great down-to-earth guy. He's not really big time. He's not one of them guys. He knows his football. He knows what he wants from his players. I think it really is a good signing, and it's just a pity they hadn't done it next week. Obviously we're there. With us playing Wednesday, we could do with. Really with him not being at the club at this moment and staying the way they were. But they've still got an awful lot to do, though, Alan, in my mind. You look at them, they've got a lot to do to get out the mess they're in, to be honest, this season.
Well, to be fair, the time Alan, people watch this, they'll know the result of the Hillsborough game because obviously we're recording it in advance of that. Well, come on to Chris Wilder. He's been speaking out this week about really what's required of Sheffield United. For him, really, to commit his future further at Bramall Lane. And I think what he's actually said, a lot of us have known for a long time about his views behind the scenes. We'll come on to that, and also Paul Warren in a moment. But James Gregg, things going on, well, things are starting to move again, finally, in sport. We can't wait, can we?
Well, yeah, we'll start by talking about the Sheffield Sharks before we get on to the main crux of what we're going to talk about because, they're on the TV every single week on Sky Sports. Mates of mine are really interested in how they're getting on. Just nice to see some familiar faces as well, Alan. Mike Tuck, of course, the Sheffield Sharks captain. He's been brilliant on their NBA sort of punditry as well. And he's a lovely man, Mike. And the Sharks doing really well. They've won 6 out of 9 matches since the turn of the year. Good performance from Matt Fitzpatrick as well, the local golfer at the Genesis Open. And then at the World Golf Championships as well in Florida, he's looking good for a Ryder Cup berth later on this year as well. Hopefully with fans back for that. Now, some results that we've already said we can't bring you because United and Wednesday both play Wednesday night as we record this. It is Wednesday afternoon. No smoke and mirrors here on Sheffield Live. Same with England cricket as well. By the time you watch this, you'll know how they've got on day one of the final test against India in Ahmedabad. Hopefully, let's just say England are 300 without loss and wins for the Owls and the Blades 2-0. How about that? We'll just make that up. But let's talk something about football that we do know. And we do know that there are plans at Meadowhead at the Sheffield Transport Ground to make the home of football, the world's oldest football club, Sheffield FC. Well, something actually that you and I, Alan, talked about with Michael Vaughan the other week on this programme, didn't we? Just something that actually deserves. We need to be a bit more noisy and vocal in this part of the world. Being in Sheffield and being in the north, we don't tend to brag too much. And I think that this is exactly what we need. So basically, it's going to be a 4,000-seater arena alongside an interactive attraction which explains the Steel City's role as the birthplace of football as well. It's built on the old Sheffield Transport Ground site. Look, it's going to be ready maybe in a couple of years' time. It'll certainly be starting to take shape in the next year or so. And there's lots of hopes that finally people will be coming to Sheffield and they'll know St Andrews is the home of golf, Lords is the home of cricket. And who would have thought it? Meadowhead is the home of football.
Excellent. James, thanks very much indeed. That can't come too soon, that move. As another thing that can't come too soon is pundits referring to either Wednesday or United as Sheffield, which drives us mad, doesn't it, on a regular basis, because there's only one Sheffield, and that's Sheffield FC. Sheffield United, Ronnie and John, you know, I talked earlier about this slight parallel. You were always expected to deliver a lot from a little. Chris Wilder certainly has delivered a lot from a little. Can it not become a double-edged sword for a manager after two almost back-to-back promotions? You had back-to-back promotions. Chris did two in 3 years. Can be a rod for your own back, can it not, Ronnie?
Yeah, it can be, to be fair. You know, because you know, people have short memories, don't they? You know, I mean, I've listened to Football Heaven every now and then when I'm driving along there, and you hear some of the Sheffield United supporters ringing up and saying, you know, do you want this, that, and the other, get rid of Chris. And but you know, you... What he's done is just been absolutely unbelievable. Last season was just unreal. It's just one of them seasons where you enjoy it as being a Sheffield United supporter. And I enjoyed it, watching it, because it was great to see a promoted club coming up like that. A guy like Chris Wilder, who's as down-to-earth as you want him to be, one of the best guys you can meet in football. You know, and what they did and achieved last year was fantastic. This year is more realistic. You know, that's the way it is. That's the way football is. You know, and you've got to realize that, you know, to have two seasons at that level at the position they were in last season, it's impossible. Absolutely. It doesn't happen. It happens that once for you, which was great to enjoy. Now, surely, you know, the people involved behind the scenes at Sheffield, I mean, you know, they can't be, and I just sincerely hope that they're not looking to go somewhere else in another direction. You know, let's get Chris going. And I mean, if they go down, which it looks like is going to happen, you know, who's better than Chris Wilder to have the attempt to bring them back into that big time again?
Strikes me he's got the same problem that you had at Rotherham. You were keeping Rotherham in the Championship somehow, but you needed that investment to kick on. And it was never realistic for you to kick on. If you're in the Premier League, or you get back to the Premier League, in Sheffield United's case, you need that higher investment in wages, don't you?
Massively. You know, it's all right getting your 180 or whatever it is, million coming in. But, you know, you have to use it sensibly. I understand that, you know, but sometimes you look at the recruitment. Now, I don't know whether Chris is involved in a recruitment or not. I don't know how it works, you know, at that club, you know. I mean, in our day, when we were always told that it was us who decided who was coming in and nobody else. Now they have all sorts of recruitment guys who ask what you're looking for, and then they go and get them and bring them in, and they might not be the players that you want, you know. So recruitment is so important, but you've got to invest that little bit more money to give yourselves a chance of sustaining and staying at that level. You know, you look at the likes of Burnley, they don't go mad every year. They don't go mad and spend millions and millions and millions of pounds, yet they survive at that level. You know, it's just having the right recruitment and bringing, you know, the right players in. But for me, you know, I mean, him and Nilly, they've done an absolutely unbelievable job at Sheffield United. And and they should be praised, and we should be giving him a statue outside the ground, never mind anything else of what he's done.
Well, Chris would take responsibility for the recruitment, most of which has been very much to Sheffield United's benefit, although there are question marks going forward as to whether he can keep that level of control over recruitment, which I think is one of the issues behind the scenes. John Breckin, you know Paul Warne well, and it's a pleasure. All of us who know Warney, it's an absolute pleasure to know this diamond geezer, if I can refer to him in that light. Something special, really, his reign at Rotherham. Long may that continue, I say. You know him well, better than me, actually.
Yeah, he's exactly what you've just said there. He's a great guy. You know, he's the football club through and through. He, as you know, he's lived in this area. His two children are from South Yorkshire because he's an Norfolk lad. But like you've said, Ronnie and myself brought him in. I've had an hand in having him three times, signed him three times. We took him to Oldham with us. And then I was with Mark Robbins back here when we brought him back. But he's just a great guy to have in your setup. certainly as a player when we had him, but his management, he's certainly done ever so well in the management field. He's got a right staff around him. He's everything this football club is about. This is the type of guy I want in charge of my football club at Rotherham United, the size of the club and everything. He's got time for everyone. He's got time for supporters. It's very, very similar to Ronnie in that way that, you know, we had time and we were out in the local community. So, yeah, he's the guy that I think is a new press guy. You know that. You ask him something, you get a proper answer from him. And he's everything. He's, as I say, he's surrounded himself. He's done a great job back, you know, the promotions that he's had at Rotherham. And he knows how it works. And for me, I just hope he's there for a long, long time, Alan.
Yeah, sure. Final word, Ronnie, on this week's show. As the manager who brought Paul Warne to Rotherham United, it must give you a lot of pride and satisfaction to see
what
he's
doing. Yeah, I think so. You know, he's a special guy, to be fair. You know, all-hearted. I mean, he played, the way he played is a bit like the way he manages. You know, he's enthusiastic. He's got really good staff around him. And he's done for me a fantastic, absolutely fantastic job. And you hear people saying, you know, Warney out and all this nonsense. I mean, who's going to come into this football club and do any better than Paul Warne can do? I mean, for me, you know, as Breck says, leave him as he is. You know, we are the yo-yo club. We are going to go up. We are going to go down. We haven't got a league in between where we're probably not good enough for the Championship and too good for League One. So enjoy the promotions and get behind the side when we go down, because it's going to happen. That's the way the club is at this moment.
Well said. Thank you so much, guys. It's been a real pleasure. What a cracking hour or so that we've had. James Gregg, thanks very much indeed as well. You know, we'll link up again soon enough, hopefully over that pint. And when we have that pint, I'll have read this fully back to back and I'll pass it on to you, and I thoroughly recommend it. Les Payne has done a brilliant job with that as well. Proceeds to Rotherham Hospice, published by Vertical Editions. Breck, My Life in Football, John Breckin with Les Payne. John, thanks so much for joining us. Good luck.
Thank you, Alan.
Ronnie, as well, for your support. And as we say, cheerio, you two are going to carry on talking, I know, for the rest of the day and the rest of the night. You try stopping them. Thanks also for watching, and we'll be back with another show very soon. Take care. Bye-bye.